You're watching Minister's Material with Prophet Emmanuel Makandiwa.
Okay, I want to appreciate you once again for coming, and I hope that today's presentation is going to be a blessing to all of you. What are we talking about tonight? Somebody's even trying to speak to me in sign language, so that it's a warning, never make a mistake. Okay. Kingdom finances, but I think we'll have to look at some few scriptures that we can use in trying to build our foundation on that area. But we have to understand that even though we are going to be talking about finances in the kingdom of God, it still has to fall under the causes of expiration, because it is so clear that when you are not financially sound and financially strong, that can be a cause for expiration. You can expire easily when there is no sufficient or adequate financial resources. So it's one of the causes of expiration. So we are going to be, it's a continuation of what we've been dealing with. Lack of money, lack of finances can cause one to expire, despite the fact that you are highly anointed and acceptable. But as long as money is not there, you will find it difficult to excel in ministry and to be influential, even in your area of influence. But obviously, since this is rather a very long subject, we can't deal with it in one go. We have to start working on it today, and it will get more heavier as we proceed and as we keep on looking at it. Let's go to the book of Genesis, chapter number 27. Genesis chapter 27. It would be good if you could just go through the entire chapter when you find time, at your own spare time. But let me take you to the 12th verse, and then the rest I'll try to explain. 27 verse number 12, Genesis. And I think it would be good if we could just read it together loud and clear. One, two, go. My father, peradventure, will fill me, and I shall seem to be to him as a deceiver, and I shall bring a curse upon me and not a blessing. If that happens, I'm likely going to bring a curse upon my life instead of a blessing. Okay, so if we are going to be talking about money, I think it would be sort of like an injustice to such a wonderful subject. Because as we all know, that money is limited. It would be better for us if we would just talk about the blessing of God and have money as the subtitle. Because the blessing of God covers a lot of areas, And money just covers money, doesn't cover any other aspects of life. So we are going to be talking about kingdom finances, of course, but let it fall under the blessing of God. Are we together? Okay. I'll try to show you some of the challenges that you cannot avoid as a leader, as a minister, if you are not properly blessed, if you are not in position, if you are not, if you have not received a blessing over your life, and if it happens by any chance that you get a position and you find yourself leading, and things are not well with you financially. So I'll try to prove to you the innumerable disadvantages that you encounter in your journey of leadership. And most of them are not even necessary. And most of those challenges, you try to attack them in prayer and you address them in prayer. And still, it seems like prayer doesn't seem to be doing you any good and yielding any results. Because most of those challenges are supposed to be dealt with financially. So it's not every challenge that you can conquer and defeat in prayer. Though prayer is very necessary. But we have to appreciate that the Bible doesn't only teach about prayer. It teaches about so many things that are supposed to be observed. So prayer is not the only principle that you have to follow. How many principles are you supposed to follow and to obey and to comply with? Then all those principles are supposed to be considered before you can become a successful leader. But in Genesis chapter number 27, we are introduced to a story. All of us, I think, we are all aware of the story of Jacob. But before chapter 27, if you look at the grandfather, Abraham, when Abraham was called by God to come out of his family and to walk out of his country to a place that God had prepared for him. And you see that again mentioned in the book of Hebrews chapter 11 when he gives you a list of the heroes of faith. Abraham is also there. And he's considered to be a great man of faith because of that move that he did from a place that he knew. He was very, very comfortable in that territory, in that place where he had his relatives close by, even if he was going to come across some challenges. It was going to be easy for him to find people that would help him. And then God called him out of that place. And all of us, if we look at it, we just see faith as if Abraham was just responding to the call of God. And yet, in actual fact, if you look at it, there was a promise. There was an incentive to that. In the book of Genesis chapter 12, when God called Abraham out of his family, he gave him a promise. It wasn't just an issue of come out and I will do nothing for you. God said, when you come out, I will bless you and you shall become a blessing. So imagine Abraham, a man of faith, We can talk of any other person, but the moment we begin to talk of Abraham, those are some of the greatest people that you can talk about in the Bible and even outside of the Bible, a great man of faith. But it wasn't an issue of just hearing the voice of God and God calling him to come out And then immediately he responded without a promise attached to the calling. There was a promise, and God said, if you do that, I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and I will make you a father of many, and you will become a blessing. So Abraham waking up early in the morning and then getting on a journey to a land that he knows nothing about, it wasn't just an issue or an act of faith. He was moved by the promise, and God had promised to bless him. God never said, if you obey that, I'm going to take you to heaven. God said, if you obey and you come out of that geographical place into another geographical place, I will bless you. Sometimes, you know, we don't really take time to look at such things. We look at these people and we think all they have was just faith. These guys were moved by the blessing of God. Without a blessing, he wasn't ready to go. You know, God knew it, that if I'm going to call him, for him to respond to that call, I have to attach some benefits to that. Come out and I'll bless you. And then he moved out of that place in pursuit of a blessing. So it's something that we cannot play around with. The thing that moved Abraham, abandoned his family, and he said, if it is about the blessing of God, see you tomorrow. So we just talk of faith there, and yet there is the blessing, the motivating factor. You do that and I will bless you. So isn't that amazing that you can come across people that will tell you that we don't just worship God because of what he gives. That's very true. But at the same time, there are so many promises to that. He that comes to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. There is a reward for seeking God. God pays you for seeking him. He's a rewarder. There's a reward for that. Not just in heaven. The Bible says, for the righteous shall be recompensed on the earth. Here, down here. Now, I think I would want to bring your attention to something very, very important here. Look at this. What I can say has been the greatest cause as to why most of us spiritual leaders or church leaders are not really blessed and sometimes not really broke, but also broke. There is this problem that I've seen. Let's try to address it at the beginning. We have not yet come to a place where we can convince ourselves that God wants us blessed. It's very difficult to believe that what I'm saying now, because everybody believes that, no, God has to bless me. But I'm telling you the truth. We have not yet come to that place where we 100% believe that God wants you to be rich. There is still a division in your brains, in your mind. You don't fully understand that. You don't fully understand that. That is why sometimes you find yourself criticizing that. And something happens again, it's a different day, you believe that. And next week you attack it, and then the following week you believe that. You know, all of us here we can say that we believe that God wants us blessed, but That is, if we are going to consider what is in your heart. You might be having one thing in your heart, but when your tongue is divided. Are we together? When your tongue is divided concerning financial matters. If you go and you read the book of James chapter 1 verse number 7. The writer explains to you about a man who is double-minded and that he should never think that he can receive anything from God. You should never think, never think. It should never cross your mind that you can receive anything. Not some few things. Anything from God. The next verse. Because a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Having two minds concerning finances. This is the main reason why you cannot receive anything from God in terms of finances. Look at your mindset. Look at your thinking concerning money as a leader. Can you openly say that you are one-minded? You can say yes to that in terms of what you have in your heart. But when we come to what you confess. Now, if you study your Bible, you realize that it doesn't matter what you have in your heart. That's why God said to Joshua, this word of the law shall not depart from your mouth. What you have in your heart cannot sometimes really work for you. Even the devil himself, he waits until you confess. That's what he collects, and he can use that against you. You might believe that. In your heart, you know that God wants you blessed. But look at how divided you are when it comes to your confession concerning finances. We have leaders like that up to now. They still not be. They don't believe that God really wants them to have money. That should be your first move. To correct and to adjust your mindset when it comes to finances. It doesn't have to be 99%. Please, if there is 81% missing from your belief, your confession, in your confession, it has to be clear that you believe it, that God wants you to prosper, to have money, and to have a blessing. There should never be any contradiction as to your confession. You know, sometimes even though we have all of these scriptures that we have to support the idea that God wants us to be blessed, we can choose to believe that in one day, but the following day, if you see one person who seems to be doing much better than we are doing and he has more money than what we have, we have got a tendency of trying maybe to attack the person, but in the process of attacking the person, we end up attacking the scriptures and the principles that are there in the Bible. It's just something, but I don't know how I can address this because we're just trying to work it now and try to take it further from where we are, but let it sink into your mind. And when you have it in your heart, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So we can tell what we have inside of your heart. From what we hear, we listen to what you're saying, and we know that you don't believe that God wants you to prosper and God wants you blessed. So the first problem that we have as leaders, it is our mindset, our way of thinking towards money. Our mindset. It is not the little money that we have in our pockets. It is the little understanding that we have in our brains concerning money. Some of us, we have insulted money. We have to ask for forgiveness. Yes. Because what you criticize, you'll never attract. What you attack, you'll never get. Amen. You only get to what you appreciate and what you cherish. That's what you can attract. Just like when it comes to the anointing of God, it's only the anointing that you believe in that works for you. It's not every anointing everywhere that works for you. It's the anointing that you believe. That's the only anointing that can work for you. A double-minded person having two minds. Hey. If you still have two opinions. Hey. I'm saying this because sometimes when you don't have it, you feel like it's God doing that. That's why I'm trying to work on that, because there are moments that when you look at yourself and there's no money, you believe that God is working out something for you. Can somebody give me reasons why God should rather have you broke than prosperous? What could be the main reason why God should have you broke? I don't understand. It's something that we have to look at as leaders here. Let's have an open mind towards this. If God doesn't want me to have money, what could be the reasons? Because he cannot deprive me of money for the next 30, 40, 40, 50 years in ministry. Just trying to teach me a lesson. Even if you're going to enroll at the University of Zimbabwe, you can't be there for 50 years. There is time for the lessons and there has to be time for graduation. If I don't have money because of a lesson that God is teaching me, at least at some point I have to go through the course and come to a place, and then I will say, okay, this is the reason why God was testing me. Not from the moment you are born until you die. No. Then if God is like that, I think we have better headmasters and principals that are much better than God. How can you have a student forever at your school? When you are training somebody, you are training that person for a particular place. Which means the person has to go through, even after failing. He can't remain there forever, even after failing. Why should I keep on being tested in the same area? I don't want you to believe that it is God. God is not found anywhere in that problem. This is purely the devil. The devil himself. Get this into your mind and into your understanding that God wants me to have sufficient funds. He doesn't want me to beg. No. No. The blessing of God to have the blessing of God. Once you begin to confess one thing and you now believe that God wants you blessed, the next thing that you need to do is to maintain that confession. For how long are you going to keep on saying that despite your situation? There is nothing in your bank account. Are you going to keep on saying that? Listen to me. You know, sometimes when I look back, I laugh sometimes and sometimes I cry. There are moments when I would minister certain sermons and you think this guy has made it in life. I remember some years back, I would preach on the blessing of God. Look into my own personal life. There was nothing like that. I'm following it up just because I've seen scriptures and it's there. These are principles. Though I have it or not. Just like when I'm not feeling okay, I can still lay my hands on the sick and they recover. Why? Because it's a principle. Once you see it in the scriptures, the fact that you don't have it doesn't mean that the Bible is lying. No. Once you begin to confess that, you have to keep on confessing that same confession. Despite your situation, you don't have it now. But what is the Bible saying concerning money? Never allow your circumstances to alter the written word of God. Never. 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 I would preach, I remember the first time when I preached about Operation Garikai, Apostle was there in Hauma. Yeah. It was something. I went on for hours and hours, and by the time I finished, people were standing, some were even climbing on the pulpit. Operation Garikai. Declaring that poverty is never from God. And after that, I didn't have anything to eat. Money is for the determined. Money goes after determined people. It was tough. Ladies and gentlemen, life was tough. My. I know what it is when God gives you a message and the message seems to contradict your present circumstances. You know, you say certain statements and you hear a misfiring. It comes back on you and you're not comfortable to talk about certain matters because you're saying, if God blesses me, then I'll talk about it. And yet, in actual fact, you have to talk about it for you to realize the blessing of God. You have to talk about it. You have to talk about it. You have to talk about it. That's why I remember some time ago I said a statement from the word of God. When Moses went to God and he wanted a solution as to how they were going to cross over to the other side. And God said, okay, you are going back and this is what you are going to do. But before you can do that, tell the people to go forward. Because opening up the waters, there was no need for him to tell the people to go forward. He was supposed to present a sermon that was going to be difficult for them to believe. Tell the people to go forward before you can create a way. It has to be a sermon first before I can provide a way. Are we together? Are we together? Tell the people to go forward. Forward way. Which means they were supposed to believe a sermon before they can see the manifestation. So God talks about it before you can see. That's his formula. It has to be talked about. One day Jesus came across this widow carrying her only son for burial. And she was weeping, she was crying, and Jesus came along. And Jesus said, "Woman, don't cry." And then Jesus raised that young boy from the dead. But before Jesus could raise that young boy, Jesus said, "Weep not." You have to believe the sermon before you can have the manifestation. It was going to be easy for Jesus just to raise up the young boy. Automatically, the mother was going to. She was going to be comforted. There was no reason for her to continue crying after the son is raised. Why would Jesus start by saying, "Weep not, do not cry, stop crying"? The easiest way to do that is just to raise my young boy and then I'll stop crying. And yet, if you look, that's the formula, that's God's formula. It has to be a sermon. You have to believe in the concept before you can have it. Am I talking to somebody?
Yes.
Ha! Just like Abraham, he was told about the blessing before it was given to him. He was supposed to believe what God was talking about. "I will bless you." God never said, "I'm blessing you, so come out." He's saying, "If you come out, I will bless you. I will bless you." And he believed God. Even the time when Abraham was now ready to be given his only son, before God could give him anything tangible, Abraham was taken outside of his house. And God said, "I want you to look at the stars, count them." This man is desperate for sons. How can we be talking of counting stars? Let's go to the river. Ha! Which means before you can have the actual thing, you have to believe in something. You have to believe the word of God concerning what God is about to do for you. Why should you waste my time? I'm not asking for stars. I need sons. So it's something that if you look at it, you realize that even before God can give you the actual thing, he would want you to believe in certain signs. There are signs that God gives you. And you have to believe in those signs. Then you will get the actual thing. You might be broke right now, but there are signs. There are signs that you have to believe in. So too many signs. You know, here I don't know how we are going to deal with this one, because from now, this is what you have to do. If you're going to now have one mind and believe that God wants you blessed, the next temptation that you have to defeat is that of having wrong people around you. They say that birds of the same feather flock together. Why should you always have people around you that you try to convince every time and they don't believe in what you're saying? You are overusing your battery. You are exerting your energy on people that were not even supposed to be around you. Wrong company. So, you know what? In most cases, I will not keep on reminding you that I'm giving you testimonies. Some of these are my own personal testimonies. I went through a lot. And what I'm giving you now, these are things that I went through. And when time came that God really wanted to cause his blessing to begin to manifest, he pointed out areas like that. Just like Abraham, come out of your family. But you know that some people, they think that maybe Abraham, he had so much faith, like maybe the faith that we don't have. It's not like every time God would speak to Abraham and Abraham would believe. Abraham had some issues in believing God. He had some issues. It wasn't one word and Abraham would listen. No, 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 no. All of us, if I ask right now, where do we find the calling? Which place do we find God calling Abraham the first time? All of us will say Genesis chapter number 12. But if you look at Genesis chapter number 12, verse 1, the Bible says, for God had said to Abraham. It doesn't say God said to Abraham, come out. God had said to Abraham, and he never listened. Until this time around, God is bringing a calling attached, and there is a promise. This time, if you come out, I will bless you. And then Abraham agreed. So please understand. So God never called Abraham in chapter number 12. He had already called Abraham in previous chapters. And Abraham never responded to that call, because there was no promise attached to it. What do I get? But finally, when God said, if you come out, I'm going to bless you. But then he made a mistake again. He took some of the people that he was supposed to leave, and that delayed his blessing again. So that's your first step from where you are right now. Begin to prune yourself. Get rid of, very sorry to use this word, unnecessary people. If you want to move forward from where you are right now, the first thing that you have to do now, as soon as possible, go out there quickly, identify the time wasters that are in your life. People that are not serious with God. So if you come around me and you say something very positive today, I will have to wait for you again tomorrow, and I would want to hear whether you are going to maintain the same confession, and I'll wait for you again until next week. If you seem to be a double-minded person, then I know that you are unstable and you are likely never going to receive anything from God. So why should you receive me? Because a double-minded man, he should never think that he can receive anything from God. Look at the people that are surrounding you. Some of you, if you cannot choose friends as a leader, you don't have your own company. You don't have your own circle. You don't have people that challenge you. It's one thing to get poverty, but the moment you get wrong company, it's a confirmation that you're going to be there forever. Because the devil knows that even if he inflicts you with poverty, as long as you can have the right people around you, you're still coming out of it. Amen. So he gives you poverty and he gives you people that can come and endorse it. Listen to your conversations. It will be a difficult assignment that I'm giving you now. It will be very difficult because those people are not ready to be left out. They will fight tooth and nail to make sure that you don't get rid of them. From the time you got into that relationship, you have to make calculations. How much have you benefited from that relationship? Am I talking to somebody here? Yes. Oh, yeah. And Isaac was old. At a time when he thought he was about to die. And Isaac called Esau his firstborn. In chapter 27, it's very, very, very interesting that what is happening in chapter 27, it's happening because the father is not aware of what might have happened before. So Isaac is inviting the son that he thought is still the firstborn. You know, I've heard a lot of people attacking Jacob that he has stolen a blessing from his brother. The father is inviting Esau so that he can bless Esau, hoping that Esau was the firstborn. And yet what the father is doing here, he's doing it at a time when Esau had already sold his birthright. These are rights. He had sold rights. Rights to the inheritance. Which means he was no longer the firstborn. So that transaction that took place between the firstborn and the secondborn, the father was not even there. So he's not aware of that. And then the father called Esau and he said to him, "My son, you can see, behold," he said, "behold, I'm very old," which means look, analyze, look at me. I'm old. It's a sure sign that I might die anytime. But that would be the most terrible thing for a father to die before he can transfer the blessing on the next generation. Behold, look at me. Some of you are blind. You have to look every time. You have to behold and to analyze. Can't you see, Esau? But I can almost die here without you guys talking about the blessing. Okay. You want me to die? And he said, "So, Father, what should I do?" And then Isaac said to Esau, "I want you to take your weapons and take your quiver and take your bow. Go into the forest. Get me game meat. I need venison. Let me eat it. And then let my soul bless you before I die." You know, you would think sometimes these are the words of a dying man, but you will see that Jacob is going to do something and he's going to go to Laban and he's going to be there for some years and he's coming back, and yet his father is still alive. Okay. Which means, it's not really about Isaac's physical death here, but it would be the death of the blessing. It can expire before you get it. You have to be very, very, very careful. There are moments when, just like when Jesus was ministering, the Bible says, and the power to heal the sick was present on him on that day. There are moments when the graph is too high Those are moments when you can receive a blessing from a higher authority. So the picture that we have here, we have got Isaac and we've got the wife and these children, and it's a leadership thing. If you want to look at it that way, it's a leadership thing. It's a structure that you can see there. And all of these sons were serving under their master, under their father. And it was time for the elder son to get a blessing from the father according to his rights, which were no longer there. And then daddy said to his son, beloved son, and Esau had never disclosed this to his father, that I'm no longer the firstborn. We're going to talk about, which one of them is a deceiver here? If Esau was going to get a blessing, if Esau was going to get a blessing, we were going to have problems there. Because when Jacob bought the birthright, he was waiting for that special moment. Why would he need birthright if it wasn't about the blessing? So the father then called Esau and he said, I want you to go out there, bring me meat. And then he went his way. Let me skip. There are so many things that happened in between. Let me try to skip and then I'll come back to that. Have you ever wondered why, after Jacob got a blessing from his father? Because as a leader, some of you, it's not like you are heading that department in every department, or maybe you are the head of that assembly. You might find yourself serving under somebody, right? And there are moments when you have to satisfy the man above you and receive a blessing and a benediction from him. Okay. It's one of those things that you have to begin to pursue. Pleasing the man. I know you might want to say God. Pleasing the man that God has placed above you. Do you know that the moment God gives somebody a position, even in the house of God, even in the secular world, the moment somebody gets a permission, he gets a special treatment from God. Some of us, we undermine authority, and we undermine positions, and we undermine structures. If there is anybody that God has placed above you, that's where the oil should flow from. Are we together? Whether you have some challenges and you have some misunderstandings and you've got a lot of questions concerning that guy, but the fact that God allowed it to happen and he is there, and God has also allowed it to happen that you are down there, it is for a reason. The moment the person gets to those levels, there is a special preferential treatment that he receives from God. Whether the person knows what he's doing or not, I can give you scripture after scripture. That's why we have prophecies in the Bible, in the book of Daniel, of King Nebuchadnezzar, who saw something in a dream, a statue or an idol that he saw representing kingdoms that were to come. Not just kingdoms, the Roman Empire and all this Grecian Empire and Babylonian, what. It wasn't just that. He even saw Jesus coming down as a stone. And he hit the kingdom, the last kingdom, the Roman Empire kingdom, and that stone grew and it became a mountain and it filled the entire earth. That was the kingdom of the Messiah that he saw. He was never born again. Nebuchadnezzar was never born again, and yet he got a revelation that we find in the Bible. And yet we have got so many other prophets that saw other bigger revelations, and yet we don't have those revelations in the Bible because they were not known for anything. But this person, because he is influential because of his position, God knew that if I'm going to give him a dream because of his position, that dream is going to find its place in the written word. Not because he is spiritual, but because of his position. Position. So the father is calling for the sons to come, which means he wants to do something. It's a spiritual transaction. He has got all the rights to do that because he's doing it from a higher point of view. Hebrews 7:7, without any contradiction, the lesser is blessed of the better. If you want to contradict that one, then it's amazing, because the Bible already is telling you that without any contradiction, which means that one, we don't have to debate about it. Which means the better, the person who is better off than you is the person that can bless you. If you want to contradict, I don't know what's wrong with you, because it's there without any contradiction. Which means this is something that all of us have to understand. That as long as you are lower down there, the only person that can bless you is the person who is doing better than what you're doing. Can we have any contradiction as to that? So the father is summoning his sons because he knows that he is at that level where he can bless, because he is better than all of them. Let me give you something that will actually create your hunger to want to hear more about this interesting story. If Jacob then went to Haran from Beersheba, and then he was there, and the wife that he wanted to marry never got her, it was difficult for him. Because remember, when he arrived, he saw that there were two girls, beautiful girls. I don't know whether all of them or one of them, but there were girls that were there. And his father had actually given him an instruction that if you are going to get married, I would want you to go and marry somebody. There is a person, your mother's brother in Haran. You go there, and then he has got a daughter. I want you to go there and marry that one. It's an instruction that is coming from the same person who has blessed him. And the man that is blessed, he's still getting instructions from the person that has blessed him as to who he should marry. Go and marry that one. Because I don't like these ones that are the Canaanites. You don't like them. Is this your wife? Go and marry that one, because I like those ones. I don't want to talk about that, but but you know that the moment somebody blesses you, he has got a right to tell you what to do, because if he just blesses you and he allows you to marry anybody, he knows that his blessing is never going to work for you. Because when you get a blessing and you allow some suckers to come around you, or parasites to come around you, he knows that you are never going to keep it. You are going to lose it. So he gives you the blessings and he tells you how you can maintain it. So the person who blesses you has got the right to tell you the people that you should move around with. Okay. And then, just think for a moment. And he worked for 7 years. And he was given the wrong wife. And he worked for another 7 years. And that time he got the right one. Because I'm sure it's because that was the last person that was there. Maybe he could have worked for another 7 years again for the right person. Okay. So 7 plus 7, that's 14 years. Okay. The wife that he should have worked for 7 years, he ended up working for 14 years. It wasn't 7 for Leah and 7 for Rachel. No, 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 no. It was 14 for one person. Okay. Okay. I want you to follow. I want you to follow. Okay. 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 And the father said, the reason why I'm giving you Leah is because here you can't do that. How can you get the younger one? This one is already old. She must have been married already. So how can you... What do you want me to do with this one? And for your own information, he was right. Because Jacob himself didn't know the consequences of taking his brother's right. Because these daughters were two, and over there, there was Esau and Jacob. So, now let me show you something. Let me show you something. So the firstborn over here, Esau was supposed to come and marry that one. But he's no longer coming because you collected his rights. So you have... Yeah. Okay, sit down. Sit down. Let me show you something. 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 That's what happens when you get somebody's blessing. You still have to go through what he was supposed to be going through if he was there. Are we together? So, 14 years. But the question is this. If Jacob had to work for 14 years to get the right person, after getting a blessing, that's my question now. If that can happen after a man is blessed, is this guy, was he ever going to get married? If... No. I wanted to get something. Imagine, this guy, what you see happening, how he's getting his reward changed every now and then, and there are so many alterations. This is happening after he was blessed. And if the blessing that he got from his father allows such a thing to happen, instead of 7 years, you have to work for 14 years to get one thing. After getting a blessing, what kind of a blessing was it? Then we are going back now. I just wanted you to have that feeling. You have to understand that. Okay, if this is happening after, because all of you here, even if I want to bless you now, you can't wait for the next 14 years to see the manifestation of that blessing. It's too much. That's what should happen before the blessing, not after the blessing. What kind of a blessing is this? People should be stealing from me before the blessing. Which means, if ever we are going to find a fault in the blessing, it is because of the fault that was in the sacrifice. You know, by now, all of us here, we have been doing a lot for God. You know that even ministering like the way you minister, it's a sacrifice to God. You know, there are so many people that do not believe even in tithe. They believe that, you know, after the cross, you don't have to tithe. That's why I said we still have divided in minds. In the body of Christ, you go to this church, they don't believe in that. You go to another church, they believe in that. You go to another church, they actually total against that. And all of these people, they believe in the same Bible. This is the confusion that the devil is taking advantage of. We are not yet a people of one mindset. And God, the devil himself knows that as long as these people are still divided in terms of their doctrine in regards to finances, they can never prosper. All these arguments that we go through, you don't see it happening. Muslims, they don't do that. That's why right now, if you go there and you find out, they don't even believe in contribution towards a project. When you see them contributing, they want to support a particular community somewhere. If they want to build a mosque, it has to be one person doing that. Two of them, three of them, not everybody. And the people that are going to be building that mosque, they have to build it according to the specs. It has to be of high quality. And in some of those mosques, you find gold. And the people that you find broke in that same religion, you never find them attacking the rich. There's no such confusion. It only happens here. It only happens in Christianity. Why? Because they believe that that's where the blessing should flow from. The moment we operate at the same level, it means nobody's going to help anybody. We should be different. We should be different. It's just amazing. It's just amazing how you can find yourself in the presence of the one that is greater than you, and he gives you a blessing and he tells you to go. From the moment you get a blessing, it's amazing. What kind of a blessing was this? From the moment he got it, that's the day he began to run. Before the blessing, this guy was comfortable. He was living a very peaceful life. And he got a blessing. That's the day he started running like a madman into the forest. After the blessing, what kind of a blessing is that? Even if the church is blessed right now, let us analyze the kind of a blessing that we have. Let's look at it. You go there. Look at the people that are coming to your ministry. As they are busy worshiping God, and you have just go outside. Move around the parking area. Look at the cars that are parked there. It's a blessing because at least these people are driving, but let's look at the type of the blessing. You know, like when it is raining, like the way it is raining nowadays, some of these cars cannot move at all. Do you know that? Yeah. People, they have to cancel the journey. Oh, my wife, it's raining again. We have to postpone the journey. You can't drive it when it is raining. I remember sometime I was driving another vehicle that I had some years ago. And I would drive from Bulawayo, come here to Harare, go to Mzaraban, and from Mzaraban go to Chiredzi. Now, non-stop. And I'm going to minister there. I remember we encountered a very heavy rain. Can't remember where exactly as we were driving out of Harare. And the wipers just ceased like that. And we tried everything. You know, there are so many ways that you can go about it, you know. I tried everything, but it never worked. I tried to get petrol, spread it on the windscreen, and I was wet. We couldn't travel. And people are waiting for me there. The pastor there is actually calling. Where are you? How far? The car is there. I have to appreciate God because I wasn't like this before. At least there's an improvement. But what kind of a blessing is it? Oh. Now, so when Esau, I'm taking you back now, when Esau went into the forest, that's when the mother said to Jacob, Jacob, my son, I heard what your father said. Your father is about to bless your brother. But personally, I disagree with that. For some reasons. Leaders, please look at this. All these two guys were born in this same house. There's only one mother there. The father prefers the other one, not because he really prefers him, but because he's got rights to the blessing. And also, despite the fact that the firstborn has got rights to the blessing, still the father is not ready to bless him just because of the rights. He has to qualify. I heard your father saying to your brother that he needs savory meat, venison, so that your father can eat and then bless your brother. But I want you to get that blessing. I want you to go for that blessing. If you look at the professions of these two sons, the other one used to work indoors, and Esau was a hunter. So Jacob would spend much of his time in the presence of the mother. And Esau, his profession, demanded that he should be away. Even from his father, even from his mother. You know, I was in trouble some few months ago. Our family there, they've been crying. I think they went to a certain place and there were some nice dogs that they saw there, and they were busy during that weekend playing with those dogs. And when they came back home, they said, we also need ours. Buy us some small dogs. We need some small dogs. It was dogs everywhere. And then I think with your help, we got two dogs, and we brought them to our house, and they've been there for some time. They were only small, just for some few days. I don't know what's wrong with those dogs. They were, right now, if you see them, they're no longer small. But ever since they came, our family, they've been playing around with them, and they spend time. I've never really got any time to really sit down and find out how they are doing. So, but right now I can tell you, now they're in good books. Those dogs, they are now in good books. If you see our family playing around with those dogs, you can see like, These people just they are loving each other. But I can tell you the truth. Myself and my wife, The last time I wasn't even there, she just walked out of the house and she came across one of those and it became vicious. Maybe I'm sure she was on the phone because Ndangon's going to eat and Okurola. But also, even myself, they don't like me. I also appreciate it because it's because I've not yet, I've never created time with them. They seem to love our girls so much. But myself and my wife, we are the owners of the property. You see, the mistake that they are doing, these dogs, they are coming into a place and they begin to create relationships with inferior people. Some of you, you do that. You know what? I've seen people like that. They are in a department and they enjoy fellowshipping with each other, not with the leader. And yet your blessing in every situation, it has to come from the one that is on top. Are we together? Some of you are very good when it comes to relationships. Only with people that are at your level. Never with people that matter. And yet if I really want to move from that property now, I can collect all of my kids. And the rest of the furniture. And I will not even tell them that we are going anywhere. Create a relationship with your superiors. Don't just enjoy loving each other down there. You can't get your blessing from your friend. Sit down. Let me explain something. Once my time is up, please let me know. We'll get to money very soon. I just want you to look at this word blessing. Blessing. So the mother said, how can Esau get a blessing when you are there? So there is jealousy there. Not just jealousy. It's not also because the mother is cunning, but the mother is the one that got a revelation from God. She was carrying the pregnancy and she went to God and God said, there are two nations in your womb. Right? Right? Right?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And the elder brother shall save the young. So the mother had a revelation. Though God had said it, she still was supposed to work it out. Okay. Do you know that there are people that might want to get a blessing? Like even from me, I might have, let's say if I've got sons that I have and they want to get a blessing from me. It is easy for most of you sons to try to please the father. And yet it doesn't matter sometimes how much the father loves you. If the mother doesn't love you, you are likely going to miss the blessing. The father loved Esau and preferred Esau. But then, I've seen that happening because most people, they love the man of God. You go into every church, they appreciate the man of God more than the wife that he married. Baba, wait, don't worry, Baba, wait, Baba, wait. That is why the pastor can hardly bless anybody on that assembly. Because his wife is never appreciated. And Rebecca said, it's never going to happen under my nose. If the father was going to ask for something different, if the father was going to say, okay, Esau, my son, I want you to prepare me something or maybe go and buy me a shirt, then the mother was never going to interfere. She was never going to have a problem. But how can the father ask Esau to prepare a meal? And yet I've got a son that was cooking with me in the kitchen. I was training him
for that particular moment. How can Isaac, my husband, order a meal from a person that I've not trained to cook? No. I'm telling you, you might not like this. If the mother doesn't like you, try to please the father all you want. Why? Because in most cases, fathers, we are just emotional. We look at what you are doing, but the mother, she has got access to God. And God can communicate to her as to which one is going to serve which one. Sometimes I can send you to do something and then you rush. And your mother sends you to do something and you forget. I love you so much. You are my son, but there's nothing that I can do. When a day comes when I'm supposed to bless you, if she doesn't agree, because she has got so many things that she wanted you to do for her and you never did it. You preferred your father more than her. And she will see to it. Not because she's jealous of you, but she's got the revelation. She's the one who got pregnant. She heard from God. So, I'm just teaching you here, if you believe in fatherhood and sonship, we'll get to that. That one, whether you like it or not, we are going there. Almost you can tell that's where we are going, right? And then she said, "You go. I want you to get that blessing. But even if we are going to do any tricks here, we should make sure that we can do any other trick. But we should never skip the sacrifice." Some of you play around. When we begin to talk about blessings, you don't understand what we're talking about. This is a biological son, and yet the father is not ready to bless until he does something. Biological son, there is blood. We're talking of the same DNA, and yet still the father doesn't want to bless a son unless a son performs a certain duty, a certain responsibility. So please, Jacob, I want you to go there. Fetch for me 2 young goats. That's what she said. Obviously, there are so many versions that talk about a sheep. And he went there and he took it. And then they prepared it together. And then she said, "Son, now I want you to take this venison, take it to your father. Let him eat and let him bless you." And then that's the verse that we read now. And Jacob said, "Mama, if my father sees that and he discovers that I'm cheating on him, he is going to curse me. I'll get a curse instead of a blessing." Look at me. Look at me, please. Mama, what you want me to do now? Be very, very careful. I'm going to attract a curse instead of a blessing. And the mother was willing to sacrifice and to live a cursed life from that day. And the mother said, If your father is going to pronounce a curse, let that your curse come upon my life. But if he pronounces a blessing, you take it. Ah, this mother is determined. Can you see that? This mother is determined. Okay, before we even go to the next verse, there is soup there. There are some goodies in that verse. Can we extract some of them? If Jacob says that, what if I receive a curse instead of a blessing? It then suggests that he was neither cursed or blessed. And there is a life like that. And in the secular world, they call it middle class. They have not yet given it a name, so I'm coming up with something here. If Jacob was already cursed, why would he be afraid of a curse? Which means Jacob was neither cursed nor blessed. He was in that, you know, when you are connecting flights, you find yourself in a place and you are sitting on a couch, and yet you are not yet at your final destination. You are at the airport somewhere between your destination and where you are coming from. You are not yet there. It's a place called in between. You can't really say you are blessed. You can't really say you are cursed. Because at least you are putting on something right now, and at least you are driving. There's a car parked outside. It's a place that you can't really figure out whether. And Jacob said, Mama, am I not going to receive a curse? You know, when you receive a blessing, it's not a sign that you were cursed. No. If you go and you read the book of Genesis chapter 1, the first time when God pronounced a blessing over Adam, actually it wasn't over Adam as an individual, verse number 28. God blessed them. T-H-E-M. The first time you hear God blessing a person, it was them. Which means if the two of you are going to disagree, you are going to compromise your blessing. Well, the two of you, I'm not giving you two blessings, I'm giving you one blessing, but this blessing is addressed to them. That's why as a leader, you have to be in good books with your partner. I'm talking about your husband, I'm talking about your wife. Because the blessing is for them. Them. Leaders, are you here? But if God blessed them, do you think it is because they were cursed? Think again. Take your time. Think about it. Receiving a blessing doesn't mean that you were once cursed. God is blessing them not because they were cursed. There was no curse before that. But they were in a certain state where they are not cursed, and at the same time they are not blessed. How could Balak call for Balaam to come and curse the children of Israel if they were already cursed? But instead of cursing them, he blessed them. Why then did he bless them if they were already blessed? It's a confusing state. But he even said it. He said, how can I curse that whom that God has blessed? But then why did he bless the person that God has already blessed? Because remember, God said it. I will bless you, and whosoever shall bless you, I will bless. You can still bless the person who is blessed. But it doesn't mean that he's now blessed because of your blessing. No. You bless him so that you can attract his blessing. Are we together? Are we together? Are we together? Are we together? It's a position. So Jacob is in that position where you find Adam before he was blessed. Before God said, I bless you, what was their state before that? I believe they were not cursed. It was that medium position, mediocrity, where you have only enough to make it for the day. And a curse brings you down from that level, and a blessing takes you higher above that level. And this is where you find the majority of the people. Obviously, you have many of them under a curse, and there's the middle class, and they're those that are rich and those that are blessed. But okay, let me try to lead you to something here. And then the mother said, please, let's go and do that. And then he said, what if I receive a curse? The fact that he's afraid of a curse, it means he's not cursed. I'm going to receive a curse instead of a blessing, which means he doesn't have a curse and he doesn't have a blessing. Are we agreeing on that one? Because I need to move on. And then the mother said, if you're going to receive a curse, which means you don't have it now, but if it is going to come, let me have it myself. If he pronounces a blessing, you get a blessing. Now you can go. And then he went. After getting prepared, because he said, Mama, you know that I'm a smooth guy. That's what he said. And my brother is hairy. And my father is going to feel, touch me, and realize that I'm not Esau. That's when he's going to pronounce a curse over my life. And the mother said, son, I know the person that we're dealing with. I'm married to him. I know how he touches. I know. Just go and take the goat. And then she covered every part where she knew that Isaac was likely going to touch. And she covered every area. But we can do any other trick, but we should make sure that there is a sacrifice. If he doesn't eat, there is no blessing that is coming. Your senior, before he can bless you, there has to be a sacrifice. Now, and then he took the venison into the presence of the father. And he said, Daddy. And the father said, who is this one? He said, I'm your son, Esau. I have brought the venison. Now rise up and eat and bless me. Blessings is something that you really have to fight for. Ladies and gentlemen, if you relax like the way you relax, even if it was meant for you, you'll die without it. You have to work it out. You have to work it out. I remember sometime when I was teaching about hearing the voice of God, how sometimes even after God has spoken to you and you are very sure that you are going to get it, it's not that, it doesn't mean that you are just going to get it just like that. After receiving a word from God, you still have to fight for what God has said. That's why God said to Samuel, go there and I want you to anoint. I said it some time ago. I want you to go there into the house of Jesse. And you are going to anoint the one that I'm going to name. He was supposed to anoint David. And God had said, I will name him. Which means Samuel was just supposed to stand there and wait for God to name the person. And God never did that. He never did that. Samuel had to work the name out until he finds the right person. Even after you have heard from God, how many of you can work out their blessings as a leader? He's there, and the father said, you mean you've brought me venison? He said, yes, daddy. And he said, how come you found it so soon? And he said, your God has brought it to me. Your God has brought it to me. And then he said, come close. Let me just have a feel of you. Then he said, ah, the skin is like that of Esau. But the voice is like the voice of Jacob. I like it especially when the Bible talks about Jacob slaughtering a sheep. Because if you look at the texture, the difference between the skin of a goat and of that of a sheep, that of a sheep is much, much smoother, softer than that of a goat. So it's likely, most likely, that they killed a sheep and prepared the venison. And he covered himself with the sheep skin. And he went into the presence of his father. At that very moment when Isaac said, the voice is like the voice of Jacob, but the skin is like the skin of Esau. He must have heard something. This is no longer a mistake. Isaac is pretending now. Because if you heard that clue, and you are so sure that the voice is the voice of Jacob, and the skin is the skin of Esau, why then proceeding? Why then blessing? Why not wait for the other person to come? Okay, if you are Esau, go out there, call Jacob for me. But listen to what is happening there. Though the Bible says that he didn't know, that's the Bible for you. But Isaac understands how even a sheep saved his own life the day his father wanted to sacrifice him. He believes in substitution. Now, he's never going to fight against the strategy. I know I've preached so much from that scripture, but I feel like every time when I talk about it, I feel something new coming. That's one of the scriptures that I've seen that you cannot exhaust. Every time it's new. That is what qualifies you for a blessing. You are Jacob. Every time when you go into the presence of God demanding a blessing, when you say, God bless me, God bless me, you are praying and you are fasting. God, when he listens to you, he hears the voice of a sinner. But when he lays his hands on you, he touches Jesus, the Lamb. He touches Jesus, the Lamb. And when God touches the Lamb, that is what qualifies you for the blessing. The voice is the voice of a sinner. This girl, I know her. She's a prostitute. But because of the skin of a sheep, the father said, okay, I know what you guys are doing. A sheep once saved my life. And God provided a lamb in my stead. I'm now alive because of a sheep that was sacrificed. So you have to get a blessing because of a sheep that you have sacrificed. And then he said, son, let me eat. And then he ate venison. Sit down. He ate the venison. And then after eating the venison, he said, now you can come and let me bless you. He was putting on his brother's garments. And then the father began to bless him. And he gave him servants. Listen to what the father said. Men shall serve you. Brothers shall come and bow before you. He is pronouncing a blessing before him. It's there in your Bible. Isn't it there? He is not saying they shall come and worship you. You shall not be a god. He's not saying that. But he's just saying they shall come and bow before you. I don't know what he's saying there. But listen to this. And then they shall come. He's blessing him. You shall have servants before he can even start a company. He's already given the manpower, amen, workers and servants. They are coming to him in form of declarations. That's a blessing. You have members when the person that is in authority in your life speaks members. Follow this. And then the father transferred a blessing. And this guy was now loaded. He went from the presence of the father. And minutes later, here comes Esau. And it happens in most cases. In leadership, some of you pastors, you can confirm this, that there are people that when you really want something to be done immediately, there are people that you prefer calling. Whether in your church, in your department, there are people that if you want the thing to be done now, you don't just call anybody. The father said, I'm hungry. And Jacob was the first person to meet the need. And the father ate in the absence of the actual son. He was busy moving up and down. He's always busy. He's nowhere to be found in the presence of the father. There are sons like that. He doesn't know the whereabouts of his father. He doesn't know. And he doesn't care. And then the father pronounced a blessing. Now this is, here comes something now. And then when he comes back, father, I'm here. Wake up. Enjoy yourself and bless me. And then he said, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? Eat what again? I've already enjoyed my meal and I've already blessed somebody. Who is that person? And then that's when Esau knew that Jacob had gotten the blessing. And then he said, is he not rightly named Jacob? He did this once, and this is the second time. And the father is actually hearing it for the first time. What are you talking about? You sold your birthright? Oh, father, bless me. Oh, father, bless me. Oh, father, bless me. Father, do you mean that you only have one blessing? How can you have such a number of sons, a huge number of sons? It's amazing how, as a pastor, you can have a lot of members and yet you only have one blessing. And your members should know that. They should work towards that one blessing. Hundreds of people that are surrounding you and yet you only have one blessing. Father, please, how about me? How about me? How about me? And then he said, I've already blessed him and he shall be blessed. I cannot reverse that one. You shall save him. Go and save him. But then when he insisted, he kept on crying. He kept on crying until the father said, okay, you shall be a slave up to a certain time. But when you have grown up and you have developed enough muscles, you shall break his yoke, which means you shall remain broke until a certain time when you make up your mind that you also want the blessing of God. So right there you can see that his poverty was given an expiry date. You can be broke right now, but go there. Sit down. Think about it. Am I dying like this? Is this the end of me? No. Develop muscles. It shall come to pass that when you have grown strong, you shall break his yoke from off your neck. Only when you are strong. I want to make sure that you get what I'm about to say now. Tell your neighbor, please get this, get this, get this, get this. Look at this. And Jacob, after some time, he ran away from his brother. And as he was running away from his brother, for your own information, he was running all day and all night. He's running away from Esau. And yet Esau never followed after him. And the main reason why Esau never followed Jacob, it is because of Esau's definition of a blessing. For the first time when he heard that Jacob is blessed, he thought every furniture and every livestock was given to him. But when Jacob fled, he never took even a goat. It was just a rod and a bottle of oil. And Esau, because of his definition of a blessing, he said, let him go. Because his definition of a blessing is money, cars, houses. That's why he never followed. And yet when you receive a blessing, it's not a check. It's grace. It's an anointing. Okay, let me show you something. Let me show you something. This is not what I'm talking about. This is what I'm talking about. Not what I'm talking about. Listen to this. Then if Jacob went from the presence of the father with a blessing that took him so long to realize its benefits, what kind of a blessing was it? Yeah. Listen to this. Listen to this. Please get this. What kind of a blessing was it? Because I don't like that one. I don't like that kind of a blessing. 14 years. No. 14 years. For you to have one member, one wife, 14. No. And yet the people without the blessing are getting it easy. So what kind of a blessing did he receive from his father? If the blessing was wrong, it was because the sacrifice was wrong. The father had said, I need game meat. The father said, I need wild meat. Not domestic meat. So, the father had a blessing, but he had already opened up and he declared the price. What I have is equivalent to meat, not just ordinary meat. game meat. So once you pay that and I will give you the blessing, it will work for you, not for 14 days. But then Jacob went and he took a sheep or a goat, not from the forest. No. Listen to this. He's taking something that his father already owns and bring it back to the owner as a sacrifice. Can I talk to somebody here? Can I talk to you here? When the father said, I want venison from the forest, the father knows the difference between a sheep and a goat, and between a goat and a kudu, an antelope. Domestic animals are those animals that have agreed to live with us. But a buffalo is a wild animal, which means people are calling me blessed because of the cattle that I have, but I've got other cattle that have refused to stay with me. So my son, I want you to go out there and bring that meat to me. I like that meat, and yet that meat doesn't want to stay here. So I need a son who can go after the wild animals and bring them here. So in as much as they are running away from me, if I can only have a son that can go after those creatures and those animals and bring them here, and then I will bless you. What is he talking about? What is he talking about? What is he talking about? A difference between a wild animal and a domestic animal is that it is only a very, very, very simple difference. The domestic animal is already there. It loves to be around me. And then Jacob went, this animal that they slaughtered, already it belongs to the man, to the father. So they took, that's why most people, when they want to get a blessing from God, they always try to present Jesus to God. And yet Jesus is not your sacrifice to God. It's Jesus, it's God's sacrifice so that he can have you. Am I doing somebody here? Okay. Let me show you something. I know we are coming from somewhere and we're very happy about Jesus. But listen, Jesus was the sacrifice that God did so that he can have you. Okay. If that is all that you need, why then did Jesus say, if you really want to follow me, take up your cross and follow? Because he died for us and he said it is finished. Why then did he say, take your own cross, not your cross? Don't tell me a cross represents persecution. Jesus was not only persecuted on the cross, he died on the cross. When Jesus tells you to carry your own cross, for what? Because that's the place where you have to hang yourself and lose your own blood. Before my blood can work for you, you have to deny your own blood. So there is a sacrifice that you see on the cross. No. Okay, I'll bring that on the other. But let me finish this one first. Get this. When the father said, I want venison from the forest. These are animals that have ran away from me. They don't want my control. And yet I enjoy that meat. But these are two sons now. There is one son that brings a sacrifice to you, and yet that sacrifice is a domestic sacrifice. So you can be in a ministry, pastors, you can have sons that are serving under you. And yet every time when they do something and you try to bless them, they are not blessed. You try to bless them, they are not blessed. You try to bless them again, they are not blessed. Look at the sacrifice. A domestic animal, it is your idea, men of God, that you give to your sons. And then they go out there and they begin to work on the idea that you have given them. And they expect a blessing. That's a domestic animal. A wild animal is when you have a son that you don't give ideas. He goes into the forest. And he brings new ideas and comforts his father. His father doesn't have to do the thinking. Am I talking to somebody here? No. Even if your father blesses you after he has told you something to do, the fact that he has already told you, it means already that idea is one of his properties. It's a local idea. It's already owned by your father. Sons, if you are working in a department and you have got your leader above you, he should not be doing all the thinking for you. Your duty and your responsibility is to go after those ideas that have ran away from your father's brain. And you bring those ideas into the presence of your father. And you say, Father, this is what I've brought. It was running away from you. And your father looks at it and says, yes. Yes, this, I've never thought of it. I've never thought of it. Which means it's a wild animal that you have brought into the presence of your father. If you bring any other idea which is already local, it takes you 14 years to realize what you should have gotten within 7 years. The blessing is wrong because the sacrifice is also wrong. If you have got 100 members in your ministry and you have to do a crusade to have the other 50 and do a crusade again to have the other 50, it means all the 100 that you have in the first place, they don't deserve a blessing from you. Because the 100 that have seen you doing what you are doing, they have heard your message. They should be the ones to take their quiver and go into the forest and bring venison, new converts, to the father. Not you as the father going out every time. We are giving birth to wrong sons. If you want to be successful in ministry, if you find yourself under any leader, from now, you have to take your weapons. God help me. I'm going to develop this ministry. The woman, the man that you have placed above me, I'm going to work towards every vision that I receive from him. Where is my instruments? Where is my weapon? Where is my quiver? Where is my bow? Where are my arrows? You should be ready to go out there and hunt for ideas so that that ministry can begin to flourish. Am I talking to somebody here? Am I talking to somebody here? You can choose. Wait for your father to think for you. Wait for your leader to think for you when you are under him. The moment you begin to execute his ideas, that's a god. That's local meat. Inyama emumusha. Yaga batwa kare. Urugo wikiraba bambuzi yao. Ifungwa zao. Is an oral. So, as a man of God, once you go back to your members, please tell them the truth. You sons, I've been deceiving you. I've never blessed you ever since you met me, because you have never done anything. If you really want a blessing, I need venison here. Wild meat here. Wild meat. Wild meat. If you are not successful in this ministry where I'm leading, and there is another ministry that is very, very successful, What is making them to be successful? I should have sons that can go there and hunt for those ideas. What is their secret? That is why the United States of America is very powerful as they are right now. You will be shocked to realize that they've got employees. You will be shocked that amongst your soldiers, some of them might be working for the United States of America. Amongst your police officers, that's how powerful they are. They are there so that they can hunt for wild animals and carry information to their father. How can an American come and work here? Who told you he's an American? A Zimbabwean working for an American government. That's why they are that powerful. Your people that you are leading, if you are under, that's your assignment from now. You are going to get out of this place. You go out there ready to hunt and make that ministry work. Begin to develop the men that God has placed above you. Begin to develop that man that God has placed above you. I'm telling you the truth. Do you know that even if your pastor was not called of God, but if you were the right person called by God under him, he was still going to appear like he was called? Prove to the people that this man God called him, not because he was called. I gave you a scripture some time ago. I'll repeat it again in the night close. After Jesus said, I'm going to be raised on third day, still they came ready to anoint a dead Jesus. They still want to serve a pastor that cannot produce what he has promised. They still want to be members of that church. They came at the beginning of the week, Sunday morning, carrying some spices ready to anoint the body of a liar. And yet some of you members of the church, your pastor says one thing and he doesn't fulfill it, and you're already running away from the church. Jesus said, I will rise on third day. And before they could confirm that, they were still ready. They were very sure that Jesus were going to find him there, still ready to serve a God that is dead. So they believed in a man. They believed him. I'm challenging you now. The man, the woman that is above you, even though he seem not to be doing it in a proper way, you can make things right yourself. We are tired of members that undermine their pastors, undermine the men of God, undermine leadership. That's why even when God promotes you, you don't have people that are ready to support you, because that's what you have been sowing all this while. When you find yourself under a man of God, it's your opportunity before you are promoted to sow good seeds.
Thank you for watching Minister's Material. Join us again next time for yet another inspirational teaching from Prophet Emmanuel Makandiwa.